Yeah. Kelly, on your mark, ready, set, go. FAMU Sports Show. If you ain't trying to win it all, what you play the game for? Bright lights, big stage, this is what you came for. Like the 100 meter, better stay in your lane, though. Home of the brand, you know we like the brand. You know you fam if you got a rattle on your tag. Never say much, you can see the sweat. Being down for the team, no, this is not a bad. Champs of the me, yeah. More rings, yeah, we need that. Where my softball team at? Bleed orange and green, and I mean that. Where the defense at? You can scream that. Courtside at the ball game, big shot. We hit the game winner, you can check the shot clock. Crossover, nice dunk, you see the hang time. The air locks, the center rockin' when it's game time. And when it's football season, you better rush down. You know the fans going crazy with a touchdown. And we got the loudest band in the nation. Marching 100, this is history in the making. And the baseball game's always so fun. Catch the highlights when we hit the home run. You know it's going down when you hear that fight song. Welcome to the FAMU Sports Show, Strike Zone.
Strike Zone. Welcome to the second edition of Strike Zone. First, shouts out to Jonathan Kelly, aka J. Kelly, for putting it down on that brand new intro. Now, do we have an action-packed show for you? Yes, we do. We've got an update on FAMU baseball and basketball, and we take a rare look at the FAMU bowling team. But first, we talk to the head man himself, Athletic Director Milton Overton, on the 2017 Investing in Champions campaign.
Thank you for having me here, and I always love talking to our Rattlers. We're excited to launch the second year of 2017 Investing in Champions annual giving campaign. And this obviously campaign involves season tickets as well. And we're off to a good start. We started last Friday, and we're at about $50,000, you know, within the last 7 days, which is fantastic. We're tracking ahead of where we were this time last year. Last year, we generated $400,000 on the campaign. This year, the goal is $600,000, rather. So I know that we can count on you to help us be very successful in this campaign in our effort to build champions in the classroom, on the field, and in life. And so I also want to, at this point, congratulate Big Daddy Cobbs, who was the very first person who purchased a 2017 Football Investing Champions package. And this is a gold package of $5,000. And so I want to thank him for being the first to do that this year. He likes us to call him Big Daddy Cobbs. So, you know, so we definitely give him that. But I want to make sure again that I talk about, you know, the need for this $600,000. So our goal for Investing in Champions, $600,000. We obviously have some real needs when it comes to scholarship. Every year, guys, you know, on an $8.9 million budget, $3 million goes towards athletic scholarships. So that means it's a direct pass-through back to the university for athletic scholarships. And our student athletes are doing a phenomenal job in the classroom. And we've got multiple teams, you know, above a 3.0. We've got a lot of scholars, you know, this year, you know, that are doing a fantastic job in the classroom. And our kids are graduating. So, you know, the investment that you make in our program is going towards to make sure that our student athletes have an opportunity to walk across that stage, you know, and build that champion in the classroom that we're talking about.
Thanks, AD Overton. That's good information, and we invite everyone to do your part to support FAMU Athletics. Now we take you out to Jessica Gardner in her first appearance on Strike Zone with a report on FAMU baseball.
The Florida A&M baseball team opened up the 2017 baseball season with a 2-1 series win over the visiting Wofford Terriers. The Rattlers began 2016 in the same fashion, besting the Marshall Thundering Herd. JoJo Durden got the first win of the season, with Aubrey McCarty capturing the second. McCarty also led the Rattlers at the plate with 8 hits for the weekend. Coach Jamie Shoup is adjusting to several new players on the lineup, including a shift for junior slugger Brian Davis, who was delegated to duties behind the plate due to the injuries of Jackie Miles Jr. A bright spot for the Rattlers was the performance by Russell Rao, throwing out the first runner he faced. Coach Shoup is elated to get the season started on a winning note.
You know, the last inning was kind of hairy there. And I told our guys, when I get to the point where I'm complaining about winning 2 out of 3 against a good ball club, it's time for me to go do something else. We'll celebrate this win. It was great for us. Our pitchers threw good all weekend, and that's the key going into this season for us. We said that our pitchers need to be better. And, you know, we gave them 3 runs the first game, or 4 runs the first game, 116-4. Lost the second game, 3 to 3-2, so they scored three. And then we had two runs going into the ninth inning when things kind of fell apart defensively for us. I thought Hunter did a great job at the end, even pitching through some bloop hits and some errors in the field. There were really three, but two on paper. The foul ball should have been caught. So he showed some resiliency there. We swung the bats pretty good. We had 11, 12 hits today again. Double-digit hits, I think, every day of the weekend. So we're pleased with the weekend and the results.
The Rattlers are happy to get the first series under their belt and are looking to improve. Here's Brian Davis, Ben Elzey, and John Capra.
We performed well, seemed to come together. Definitely everybody was excited about being out here and finally playing somebody else in a different uniform. So it was just a great weekend.
Oh, it was nice to get underway. I mean, we've all been practicing hard, waiting for the next few games to come around. We got Auburn on the road next, and we're all excited to go play there again.
Yeah, it's important to start off the game right. I mean, it sets the whole tone for the whole game. Everybody follows what you do. You're the first guy up, so it's important to start off right.
From Moore Kittles Field, this has been Jessica Gardner with your opening series baseball report. Now over to the Lawson Center for Jessica Ward.
Basketball season is coming to an end, and the Florida A&M University women's basketball team, as well as the men's basketball team, will not be playing any more games at home. FAMU's women's team ended their season with back-to-back wins. Their first win was against Norfolk State as they defeated the Spartans 51-59. They then came into their last game at home and beat the Hampton University Pirates 62-44. We got to sit down with Coach LaDawn Gibson, and here's what she had to say.
Exciting win for the ladies, for the program. They came out hungry, refused to lose. I bet we played great team ball tonight. Just very excited to perform and executed well. Just looked like they had fun tonight. And as a coach, I'm very excited. You know, look like we're going the right direction, winding down the season, going to tournament. So just very excited about the win. We're not looking at numbers. We just want to win. We took our share of losses, and right now we're just trying to win and bring this men's championship to the house.
The men's team hasn't had as much luck. They lost both of their home games, being defeated by the Spartans first in a double overtime matchup. They lost the game 77-65. And then Hampton University came onto their home court and defeated the Rattlers 76-69. We spoke to Coach Byron Samuels at the half, and he discussed how important it was for the Rattlers to attack the basket against Hampton.
Well, I think we've got to play with a lot more energy, Jessica. I thought we started out flat. I don't know if that's the results of Saturday's double overtime game or not. But just trying to find a lineup that had energy and had some life. I thought we found it at the end. We still missed too many layups and settled for jump shots. I think we continue to try to drive the basketball to the rim. We've got to defend. We've got to rebound.
I'm Jessica Ward, and this is Rattler Courtside. Back to you, Alfonso.
Thanks, Jessica. Great reports from the field. We've got so much more to come on Strike Zone, and we'll be right back after these messages.
I've always loved science as a kid. At the age of 14, I developed an innovative stitching technique. I decided to hone my skills at Florida Agricultural and Mechanical University, majoring in chemistry. FAMU's learning environment has pushed me forward in making my dream of becoming a trauma surgeon a reality. Oh, did I tell you my twin brother is here too? FAMU has pushed me forward in my college career path of becoming an environmental attorney. So what are you waiting on? Let FAMU push you forward.
I picked FAMU because of the school spirit.
Because it's a family.
Strike with us.
Strike with us.
Strike with us.
Strike with us.
I chose FAMU because of our rich culture.
The only reason why you choose FAMU is the number one HBCU in the nation.
Strike with us!
I chose FAMU. I love FAMU. You should
strike with us!
And we're back. The FAMU golf team is preparing to take on the 2017 campaign, and host Deja Martin heads out to Southwood Golf Club to talk to the Lynxers.
Florida A&M's golf team is geared up and ready for a competitive 2017 campaign. Coaches Marvin Green and Mike Rice have assembled a team with the makings to possibly be the top MEAC school. For the last 3 years, the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference has sponsored a championship golf tournament, making golf officially sanctioned by the conference. For FAMU, they're one of the five schools who sponsor golf, with Augusta University granted affiliation in that single sport, allowing the champions an automatic qualifying bid to the NCAA. The young team is ready to get going
on the links.
I'm looking to some very great things this golf season. The coaches did an outstanding job recruiting this year. We have a very young team, but all of them can play very well. I feel like the old man out of the group. I'm the graduating senior, and it's only their second year here, but every single one of them can play, and I'm very impressed with every single one of them. I look for great things, possibly maybe one or two wins, and hopefully we can bring back a MEAC or National Minority Trophy.
My expectations are high. I feel like we have a great team, even though we're young. It's five freshmen on the team. I feel like we can definitely go out there and win maybe one or two tournaments this year.
This is just a great program, you know. The academics as well as athletics really appeal to me. It's basically my dream school.
The coaching staff is excited to once again have a full team. They're looking forward to a competitive season with the FAMU Linksters.
Some folks might consider that to be a weakness, but I also think that when you have a young team, it could also be a strength because they don't know fear. You know, they don't know what it's like to kind of be up against those ropes, so to speak, and being on that par three and hitting over that water with the championship on the line. So in some ways, while we are kind of rebuilding the program and kind of getting us a new foundation, we've had some great classes the last couple years, and that's what it's all about, is getting guys in school, helping them to matriculate at the university, and of course eventually get that degree. But then there comes a time every once in a while when you have a couple of those things happen, either back-to-back semesters or back-to-back years, and you have a young team. So having five freshmen, these guys are competing. These guys are competing hard every day. You know, nobody wants to kind of be left out. Nobody wants to not travel. You know, we have a senior who's doing a great job leading the team as captain. You know, Dennis is doing a great job. And so we just expect us, really, our future is bright, but we're not giving up on this season by any stretch of the imagination.
The Rattlers will host the Rattlers Spring Invitational next week at the Southwood Golf Club as they prepare for the MEAC Golf Championships April 27th to the 29th, 2017 at the Crosswinds Golf Club in Savannah, Georgia. We'll keep an eye out for the golf team this spring. But for now, back to the studio.
Thanks, Deja. We'll be right back after these messages.
I picked up the saxophone when I was 11 years old, and after that, I never looked back. I've had the opportunity to make music with some of the greats, and even perform for the legendary B.B. King. Right now, I'm composing the soundtrack for the music of my life. And of all the stages that I've ever performed on, this one, on the hill, hits closest to home. I'm prepared to perform in any area of my professional career, because FAMU taught me.
Florida A&M University School of Business and Industry now offers a one-year MBA program online. Join SBI's global community of accomplished alumni.
I encourage others to look at FAMU's online MBA program. You just never know where it might take you.
The Florida A&M University School of Business and Industry.
Correspondent Maya Dubois checks in with the Lady Rattler basketball team in this week's edition of Rattlers Unwrapped.
Hey y'all, Maya here with another edition of Rattlers Unwrapped. I'm seated here with Ejener Utical, and we're just going to see how well her teammates know her. So Ejener, who's your celebrity crush? All right, Victoria, so how well do you know Ejener?
I think that I know Eve very well.
So who's her celebrity crush?
Oh, shoot. Will Smith. Odea. Man, I guess I don't know E.
You don't know E?
I don't know E, man.
What's your main nickname that you go by? So, Don, how well do you know Ejener?
I know her like the back of my hand.
Like the back of your hand? What's another nickname she goes by? I know y'all call her E, but she said there's something else behind that.
Baby? E, baby? E, money!
Oh, she got money! She had money and everything.
I never call her that, though. I just call her EC.
So I heard that you have some pipes and you know how to sing, so I just want to know, what's your favorite song? You can't tell me, you have to sing it to me. All right, Shalonda, so I just talked to your teammate, Ejener, and I want to know, how well do you know her?
Okay, her name is E. Nobody call her Ejener. Her name is E.
But I know Eve pretty well. We real tight.
All right, so what's her favorite song? You can say who it's by, but you have to sing the song.
All right. Trey Songz, for Atlantis. Just a friend.
But you say I'm just a friend. Hey, but you say
I'm just a friend. Oh, baby, you got what I need, yeah. She's lying, because it's not.
I swear she never sang that song. She's lying to y'all. She's lying.
Oh, man. E, they say you never sing this song. Ever?
Ever. I don't care. She has a new song she likes every day, so.
You're not the first one to say that.
It's Trey Songz, or it's the girl that's singing, oh, you got a new, you think you got a, she ain't got nothing on me.
All right, E-Money, so you got some explaining to do about this favorite song. I heard that it's
favorite song every day.
All right, so y'all heard it here first. Thanks, y'all, for joining us on Rattlers Unwrapped. Catch us next time on Strike Zone.
Yay!
Thanks, Maya. And now we head over to Bragg Stadium, where Ebony Ivy sits down with an exceptional Rattler football player. Let's head out to the gridiron to meet Doc Lucky.
Ebony Ivy here with Doc Lucky, FAMU wide receiver and most recently named freshman class president. This is an interesting combination, as most athletes don't usually take an interest in politics, which leads me to my first question. Doc, you had a lot of success in your campaign season. How will you translate that on the field?
Campaigning is always about who wants it more, and it's about practicing and getting to know people. So I think that it will translate to the field by, you know, practicing makes perfect. And ultimately, it's always about who wants it more in the end, and that will determine who will win.
So Doc, you had a lot of courage to run for a position on campus. What inspired you to seek office?
Well, my whole life, I've always had a yearning for leadership, and I've always wanted to help people. So I thought that this was like the perfect opportunity for me to do both. And I just wanted to do the best that I could and represent the class.
Okay. Awesome. So if there was a song that you could name that describes your drive on and off the field, what would it be?
It definitely would have to be Get Up and Get Out by Outkast from Southern Playlistic Cadillac Music.
Awesome. Well, I'm Ebony Ivy here with Doc Lucky. Doc, good luck on the rest of your season. Back to the studio.
FAMU's Lady Rattler bowling team has quite a tough task. They have to perform in both the fall and spring semesters and keep up a grueling schedule. We'll take our first ever look at Coach Karen Brown and the FAMU bowling team.
FAMU's bowling team has the longest season of all of the teams at FAMU. Their season begins in the fall and goes all the way into the spring, with the championship being in late March. The Rattlers have begun a successful campaign in the highly competitive MEAC, which indicates that whoever is hot at the tournament will be who is in the championship. We sat down with Coach Karen Brown, and she shared her thoughts on the 2016-2017 season.
You know, we go out, we recruit hard. We try to bring in young ladies that are the face of the program. We try to bring academically strong and talented young ladies, in addition to with some skills. And it's so far this year, it's panned out really good academically. I'm very, very proud of them. And toward the, we're in, I guess, the second half of the season, which we started in October and we'll be finishing in April, a very long season. So I'm very proud of their growth and their overall team experience that they're having.
Brown revamped and rebuilt her entire team. Only one player is returning from last year's team. Junior Jasmine Aaron is that player, and she not only serves as the captain, but she is also like an assistant coach. The way that she has helped her teammates to adapt to not only playing in college, but also the college experience. We sat down with Jasmine and her teammates, and this is what they had to say.
It's fun because they're like very open-minded, and they don't have like prejudgments of anything, and they're all great, so it's just fun, I guess.
It's been a pretty new experience, definitely a challenge because I'm so far away from home. It's kind of like a new environment. I have to get used to new people, being surrounded by different people instead of people at home, so it's kind of like a big change, but I think it's been really fun so far. I've met some really good teammates. I have a lot of fun with them, if you can see, so it's been pretty good.
I want to improve on taking advice from other people and making new adjustments.
I am making an adjustment, but it has been difficult. I feel like as far as the lanes compared to high school, it's a lot more challenging, but I'm making an adjustment.
It's a big kind of adjustment, learning, you know, the new type of oil patterns that I never really bowled on before, coming from high school to college.
It's been fun. It's been really different. It's like really different high school. I like missing school sometimes to, you know, do what you love, so I really like it. We've been really, like, got a bond over it and going to the hotel, having, like, little days and stuff. So.
I try to give them a little leeway as far as getting in some extra time for academics and not try to work them as hard because we do have a grueling, a long season, and the competition weekends are really, we do about over 75 games on a weekend when we have competition, so it's pretty tough on them. So Coach Christie, she helps a lot with their PT, so it's really good.
The Rattlers look to have a successful campaign leading up to the MEAC Championships March 24th to the 25th in Chesapeake, Virginia. Now back to you in the studio.
Let's hope those Lady Rattlers can strike, strike, and strike again. We'll be back in 60 seconds.
Pink FAMU because of the school spirit.
Because it's a family.
Strike with us.
Strike with us.
Strike with us.
I chose FAMU because of our rich culture.
The only reason why you should choose FAMU is the number one HBCU in the nation.
Strike with us.
I chose FAMU. I love FAMU.
You should
strike with us.
In today's high speed, content rich world, messages get lost in the noise. The ability to see the bigger picture becomes increasingly difficult when there are so many pitches. Sometimes it takes elevation above the noise, a higher perspective. Go higher.
Well, I see our athletic department growing to really excellence in everything that we do. And what does that mean exactly? It means that we are always competitive, you know, competitive to compete for championships, MEAC championships, national championships in every sport. That's the expectation that I know that our fans expect, and that's where the Rattlers are supposed to be, always number one. Now, how do you get there, right? There's a process of building a championship program. You know, you build it through making sure that you've got the resources that you need, and that's what the Investing in Champions campaign is all about. You know, we had to have an annual giving campaign, you know, that's tied to football season tickets in order for us to build upon the resource structure that we have. The first, build the balance the budget, and then two, then begin to grow the budget so you can reinvest in the program. So we've got a couple of our alumni that have come back, and we've asked them to talk about building champions in the classroom and making investments to the athletics. So Pam Oliver, what do you have to say about building champions?
Hi everybody, I'm Pam Oliver with Fox Sports. I'm also a proud alumnus of Florida A&M University, Rattlerettes. Thank you very much. That was the team that I participated on all these many years ago when I was a member of the track and field team. Please go to FloridaA&MBuildingChampions.com and make a donation so we can make this happen.
Well, we also have Erica Hill, who's a big-time donor for us. She's done a tremendous job helping us with baseball, and we've asked her, Why did you make your contribution to the athletic department?
So my motivation for donating, first of all, I don't think you are ever too young or too old to give back. I think giving back is something that each of us can do and should do regardless of your age. Now, how you give back may look different. It may be with your time versus your resources, but I think everyone should give back. For me, as I mentioned, FAMU has done so much for me, and so it was how can I give back to the institution that basically gave me an opportunity, that believed in me.
I want to invite you to build champions with us today in the classroom, on the field and in life with academic integrity and excellence. You've heard that from me before. And we're making progress, guys. I know that you can see the incremental steps that we're making to build a championship program here from start to finish, a program that you can be proud of, a program of excellence that you can expect that we always compete for championships. And so I just invite you today to build championships with us.
I don't know what time it is, but you do. It's time to debate a sports subject that may or may not be related to FAMU Athletics. Let's kick it over to Andesha Robinson and the crew for this week's Final Strike.
Andesha Robinson here today with the Final Strike. Today I'm joined by Robert Leakes, Jessica Gardner, and Kimani Fleming. Today's topic will be, should a player's off-the-field behavior affect them being inducted into the Hall of Fame, or if they're already in the Hall of Fame, should they not be in it anymore? Robert?
Sure, why not? You think about all the off-field issues with domestic violence in the NFL, and you think about the issues with Barry Bonds, doping, and Pete Rose being the all-time hits leader for the MLB, but gambling on his team for years, for uncountable years. You just think about little incidents like
that. Understand, though, that these people are all humans. Granted, they are the face of sports. However, they are human.
What does human have to do with being an icon? When you're an icon and you're a figure, being a professional athlete is along the lines as being a celebrity. We judge them on the smallest things, like what they walk out the house in.
But that should not affect the Hall of Fame is based off of their talent on the field, not off the field.
Is it solely based on their talent, or is it based on the persona that they have while they're in the league?
Absolutely.
You have to portray the league in a manner.
That's the problem, is the Hall of Fame, who is voting for these players to get inducted into it? It's all about, you know, the politics behind it and the image, because there are little boys that look up to these players. It's understandable. However, it should be looked at as their professional career. We have a personal life and a professional life. And what they do professionally is how it should be measured if they achieve that greatness.
So who fuels the game? Is this the fans' game, or is this the players' game? Are we watching football for the players, or are we watching football as fans?
I mean, it's arguably both.
It's arguably both. Well, you're telling me that it's okay for my child to watch on live TV and watch on the internet and see Ray Rice, the Super Bowl winning running back that played for the Baltimore Ravens, see him punch his girlfriend out, punch her lights out in the elevator.
However, the problem is, if he is not, you know, if it's not affecting him on the field, if he's still performing, if the stats are there, and he's deserving of that honor, why take that away?
Because of his talent.
Because of mistakes.
Okay, well, hold on. Let's bring it full circle. We have two players that were on the same team, you know, Warren Sapp and Derrick Brooks, both were great athletes, one from the University of Miami, other from Florida State. Let's take both of them. Warren Sapp, phenomenal. But off the field, he had a lot of issues. But on the field also, he still had issues. He was kind of a dirty player at times. Let's take Derrick Brooks. On the field, hard working, man. He almost had almost like a hard hat type of mentality. Let's go to work, let's get it done. And then let's also look at off the field. He started school, and he done so much for the Tampa Bay area, especially with starting school and helping the kids out in the community. Both of these players are in the Hall of Fame. One is kind of controversial, and one is what you would want to have in the Hall of Fame, a leader, you know? And just look at these athletes, as they said, as you said.
Exactly. I feel like being in the Hall of Fame says something about you. That means you're a cut above the rest. You went above and beyond in every facet of the game. It doesn't matter what you solely do on Sundays. It matters what you do in preparation. It doesn't matter what you do just shooting the ball. Anybody can shoot a ball. It's countless players out there that are phenomenal athletes. DeMarcus Cousins is a phenomenal athlete, but he has the worst work, like the worst background in the league right now. DeMarcus Cousins, we're a little almost halfway through the season. He's one technical foul away from being suspended for a game. And every other technical foul after that, he'll be suspended for a game. You tell me that's not gonna come back to haunt him down the line? He couldn't stay in games. He couldn't play whole seasons. His team missing him in the playoffs because of his on the court antics.
Well, that's on the court. That's on the field. We're talking about off the field right now. We're talking about situations where you have domestic violence situations. We're talking about all of those things. Those are off the field issues.
I'm sorry. That's actually glad that, you know, Kimani brought up the whole Tampa Bay area and the Florida State area, because I know everybody's familiar with Jameis Winston. He's still new in the game, so, you know, of course he has a little way to go.
Exactly.
However, the crab legs and the supposed rape, you know, how will that affect him? As far as people look at, you know, him in a certain light now, so he might be one of those that might not get into the Hall of Fame because of that.
Very, very, very hot topic today on the Final Strike. Thanks for joining us, and catch us next week on Strike Zone.
Strike Zone. Strike Zone. Strike Zone. Strike Zone.